One, two, three, four.
Goodbye cold, goodbye rain, goodbye sorrow.
The solo version of Queen of California, as seen in the Vivo video, differs greatly from the album version on Born and Raised. That one's very mellow with some nice slapping in it, whereas this one is 105 beats per minute and almost has a bluegrass feel. We have a capo on the 4th fret in standard tuning, and the picking is almost done entirely with the thumb and first finger in a claw technique. The song consists of a verse, a pre-chorus, a chorus, and then solo and a different outro part. And each one of these has their own variation. So let's get right into it. So let's just look at measure one. That's measure one. And I wish I could just say, that's it, do that 80 times, that's your verse part, that's your instrumental intro part, but it is not, it's different every time. This part's the same. But after that, it turns into stuff like, all these slight variations. And you don't have to play them like that. You can kind of let your fingers wander. As long as you're fretting the right notes here, it's probably going to sound good. So measure one in depth. We're fretting with our thumb on E3. This is relative to the capo. It's actually the 7th fret of the E. We're doing a double hammer-on. Fretting with our first and second finger on B to B1, and then open D to D2. So, let's loop that. And then we follow that up with. And that part we're adding is with the thumb we're hitting the E3, first finger is hitting the B1. And then we're lifting our second finger off that D to hit the open D and open G. Good exercise here. So we're picking the outside of the strings, and then we're picking two strings right next to each other in the two open strings. And this demonstrates the claw technique we have going. We're using our thumb and our first finger to pick everything. And the claw is either wide or small to pick adjacent strings, and we kind of vary the size of our claw to pick with a string in between, no strings in between, or lots of strings in between. So from the top, that part, we'll loop that bit. After that, we get into this neat little hammer-on lick and run down. There is, we have the open D, we're hammering on to D3, and then we're plucking the D3. So it sounds like this. And then we're coming down with the B1, coming down to the D2, hitting the B1 again, and then that open D, and then finishing off with that B1. Like this, a neat thing happens with this B1. We do a pull off as we hit that next note. So with this sounding, with one without plucking it, we pull off like that as we pluck that bass note with our thumb. And that is the first measure. Second measure has a tiny variation on the second half. It starts off the same way. So that's why we use the thumb on the E3, because of this lick. And that lick is a pull-off from D3 to D2 really quickly. Grace note pull off. A little bit of a slower pull off from D2 to D, open D, then the A3, and then the open G. Like that. And if we weren't using our thumb for that, we wouldn't be able to do that. Traditional fretting, whatever you do. So you purists out there, if it was good enough for me, it's good enough for God, and it's good enough for you too. Use your thumb. One more time from the top, slow with measure two. The timing of that lick will change later on. Usually the first pull-off is really quick. Sometimes it's triplets. But I'll point those out when we get to them. So a lot of the song involves going between that first part, the rundown part, and then the lick. You can go between these, and have yourself a nice bass for the song. Let's look on to measure three and the variation there. First part is the same. This open string hammer-on from D to D3 has the addition of this B1 note. So we're doing a double pluck here with our first finger hitting the B1 and the hammer-on happening at the same time. And the rundown is different. We have this D2, open G, open D. This gets done a lot. A lot of them are ending on that for the majority of the song. So measure three, slow. Double hammerhead. And the sparser rundown. Measure four. Let's see if you can hear the difference. So did you hear the difference there? Instead of going, we go. We throw that open G in there instead of hitting that third D3 second time. And the same ending. So again, a lot of these, we have the same intro part. And it's this point that follows where the changes occur. So one more time, that's open D to D3, open G, and then the B1, and then a little rundown D2, open G, D, open G. So we've heard a lot of variations. We've heard. And. So they're there. You can do them if you want. Don't be a slave to the transcription. Don't do it note for note. Try to set yourself on autopilot and wander around these different options available to you. And throw that lick in there. Measures 1 to 4 are instrumental. The only other one I want to draw your attention to is measure 8. Just because it ends like this, we have a D3 to the open G, and then open D, open G. So add that to your list of potential endings. It's important to let everything ring. Fret as clean as you can and try to keep your fingers in such a way that the adjacent strings you're playing, you don't disturb the ones that you want to ring out. Because a key element of this song is to let these strings ring out over top of each other. One note about the picking, we're always alternating between the thumb and finger. Thumb, finger, thumb, finger, thumb, finger, thumb, finger. Especially on the 16th notes like these ones. We have to alternate to get the speed. The only times where we use the same digit twice in a row, the thumb in this case, is when the notes are eighth notes and they're a bit longer and you have time to reset and put it into play for the next note. But you notice, as soon as we get into the fast 16th notes, we're forced to do alternation. Thumb, first finger, thumb, first finger. Another time where we're going to use the thumb twice in a row is on some of the hammer-ons. And that's because that first note sounds with the thumb, the second note sounds with the left hand, we don't even need the thumb, and then the third note is the thumb. So that almost turns it into a fake eighth note. So those are cases too where you're going to use the thumb twice in a row. Apart from that, those are the rules of thumb for using your thumb, and you'll find you're going to be alternating for the majority of this piece.
I'm heading out west with my headphones on. I'm boarding a flight with a song in the back of my soul.
Measure 9 is the first pre-chorus. We have a C shape we're going to do here. And that's relative to the capo, because that's not a C chord. It's a C shape. The chord it's sounding is actually an E. And it's because of the capo that lets us do that. It turns that C shape into an E sounding chord. And we're going to do the C. We're going to pluck the bass note. We're going to strum it. We're going to start a series of alternations. What's going on here is we've got our little claw here. We're going between the two inside strings, the D2 and the open G. Then we're going to make our claw a bit wider and move it up a string to alternate between the A3 and the open G. So that's now between strings 5 and 3. Then we're going to drop our claw down a string and alternate between strings 4 and 2. That's the D2 and the B1. Before going back to the inside strings 4 and 3 here. So really slow, that alternation part is. But you understand the concept now that I've explained it. We just have the claw doing its thing and just moving up and down to alternate between different gaps of strings. More of the same in measure 10, except we have an A minor shape this time. And it sounds like this. So we're in that root note. We have the open A, and we strum that A minor shape. Start all alternation. I won't explain it this time because you've already seen it. Pattern's a little different. In this case, her thumb always hovers over that fourth string and stays there. We end off with two of the same. So one more time slow. Measures 11 and 12 return to the main theme. Chorus proper. That starts with a D shape. And he does this. So it's the D shape. And he plucks the open D and the E2 on the outside portions of this D shape chord. And then he starts alternating. Alternation is open D and then B3, open D, and then E2, he goes up high, and then a series of open D, B3, or resting on that open D. Let's play that slow one more time from the top, the D shape. Shape. We have this A3, D2, and then this B3. So if we count up from the root, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, we just did the major scale there, so that's a 9. So that's a C add 9 shape. We strum that. I like to give it a little shake and then this little lick. And that is a E1 to E open, B3 to B1 to B, G2 to G, and then the open D. And the way I pick it with my fingers is I start off with the first finger doing the E1 to E, and then use my thumb for everything else. Because that way, you kind of stick your finger here, your hand here, first finger does this part, and then the thumb goes. You don't really have to move all that much, just. And again, try to let everything ring out. Let the preceding notes be in play by the time you move on to the next one. Like that. So we have a lot of things ringing there. So one more time from the top, from the D chord. We're in verse 2 now, starting in measure 15, and in measure 16 we hear this being added to the second part of the lick. So he's fretting with his pinky the high E3, and the alternation is between the 4th string and then the high string, 4th string, 2nd string down, and then the 3rd string. So in the context of the lick, so it's 4 to the highest string, 4 to the next lower string, 4 to the 3rd string, like that. So slow. And this part of the lick is still the same. But instead of what we were doing before, we're going. Sometimes that's where we go hammer on and then open G, and other times it's hammer on and then pluck it again. And that's the one major inclusion in that one. He does that a couple times. Other than that, he's just doing that other riff.
Looking for the sound that Neil Young hung after the gold rush in 1971.
Coming out of the verse, which also contain a couple of variations that I didn't go over, but you can see in the tab, we carry on that idea with this high E3 note being tacked on, and we do that C shape, and we include that note there. And that's played like this. So it's the low A3 note, the thumb, strum with the thumb, making sure to sound that high note now that we're adding it, and then just alternating. When you do this yourself, don't worry too much about which notes you're alternating. Throw them in there. As long as you're fretting the chord right, they'll sound good. And then with the A minor shape, same thing. Keep that high note in there. And this is strange. He departs. He doesn't do a low note and then a strum. He actually finger picks the whole thing. So I'll just play it the way it sounds on the track. Bit of a departure. Nice little variation, but you can actually do this. The low note, strum, and then alternate whatever you want. One more time, slow, measure 24. Before going back into the theme. Chorus sounds like this. This part is exactly the same. So the chorus, slightly different the second time around. He plucks both notes together, the E2 and the open D. Before settling down into this common alternation. So that is the chorus 2. After a return to the intro bars to get out of the chorus, we arrive at the solo, starting at measure 31. And this is a great solo. It's a lot of fun. It's what I call a fake boom chugga, because Mayer is not a Chet Atkins or Tommy Manuel type player, but he can fake it like the best of them. So that's measure 31, slow, and that features a slide two-note chord slid up two frets at the same time we hit a bass note. So the two-note chord is the B1, first finger, and the second finger on G2, and our thumb is fretting the E3 in the bass, and we do this. So we take our first finger and we hook it under the B string, and our thumb is already on the bass note, and we kind of pinch our fingers together. And this allows us to follow our only first finger and thumb plucking rule. So we do that, and we go back to the bass note, and then the highest note of the chord, bass note, and the second highest note of the chord. Like that. And if you're working on this slide, and you find you're doing the slide like 50 times in a row, you're going to rip out the calluses in your first and second finger. When you're practicing this, you don't have to do the slide, you just go... That's what I did, because I was ripping the hell out of my fingers. After that part, we go back down with the slide without an accompanying bass note. This is a sign that it's a fake boom chukka, because a real Chet Atkins guy would have thrown a bass note in there. But it still sounds awesome. So after we slide back down, we go to the bass note and then the B1. And we do this really neat thing on the G string. We hit it twice, followed by hammer-on from the open D to D2. So those are the last four notes of measure 31. And this just shows you that you can hit a single string in quick succession if you use your thumb and first finger. That's one of the pluses with this. Not quite a flamenco style, but it comes in handy. So let's do that whole thing slow from the top. So I just want to draw attention to those last four notes. We start with our thumb on the open G, and then we come up with our first finger on the open G, and then our thumb plays the open D and hammers on. You can practice this if you want. It's like I could use some practice at that too. One more time. Measure 32 slow sounds like this. And in context with the previous measure, kind of see how they roll into each other. And it's that hammer-on in measure 31, that the last bit that goes into 32. And then this lick. Then we go to measure 33, which is a repetition of measure 31's theme. Same thing. Here it changes. We go to the bass note and we have this high E3 for going to B1. So we go high on the next time we hear that theme. So measure 34 is when things start to get complicated. I'll play it for you slow. With the bass note ringing from the previous measure, we hear this. Ending with this open A to A3. So what makes this part complicated is it's one of these boom chugga things. Sometimes you're playing alternate notes, sometimes you're playing two notes at the same time. You have this bass note, which is the same. I'm going to refer to it as the bass note from now on. And then you have this melody. And you play these both at the same time. And it's a question of knowing which times you play the bass note on its own, which time you play the melody on its own, which time you play the bass note and the melody together. So coming out of the previous measure, I'll show you how that works into each other. It complicated. Let's break measure 34 down. So with that bass note ringing, the bass note is the E3. We have that double hammer on bass note, B1, bass note, open G, bass note in the open D together, bass note in the open B together, bass note, open G, bass note, open B, and then hammer on from the A to the 3. Let's just play it without me yakking. So there's a lot of alternation at the beginning. Bass, finger, bass, finger. And then right in the middle, we have those two together parts. And that really ties that measure together. So it's the bass note and the open D together, and then the bass note and the open B. Then we go back to alternation. Bass, open G, bass, open B, and then hammer on. One more time, slow. Measure 35 slow sounds like this. It's based off a C chord shape. So there's a lot of just-in-time fretting and unfretting to work that melody, and we actually hammer on into that C-shaped chord. So the first thing we do is we pluck the A3 and the open D, and we hammer on to D2, like that, hammering onto the C chord shape. Then we strike that D2 and start all our alternation. You're lifting and fretting the second finger a lot. It's probably best to look to the tab for the details here because it's a bit complicated. Before going into this neat thing with an A minor shape in the next measure. Measure has this with a A minor chord shape. We hit the root, and then with our thumb, we're doing three strums, a high one, two ones in the middle of the road, and then with our first finger, we're picking out single notes, going back to the strum, more single or double notes, strumming again, single note, and then alternating our way out of it. And you can play that pretty messy. It sounds good either way. So one more time, slow. That's measure 36. So we're plucking. This is a lot of thumb. Four things with the thumb to start off. And the first finger is doing the single notes. Strumming with the thumb. Single notes with the first finger. Before going into single notes at the end. Measure 37, get ready for some more boom chugga. Sounds like this. Kind of neat. What we have there is with that, we have a B sounding from the previous measure. We go into the bass note, the bass note, E3. And then we fret B3 and we plug B3 and the open D together. And then the bass note, and then the open G. And then we have the bass note and D3 together. Bass note, open G, and then this lick. That's D3, 2, 0, and then A3, and then the open D. Let's do that slow without me talking. Time slow, and just pay attention to when you're plucking the bass and the melody note together, when you're alternating them, and you'll be fine. Measure 38, more of the same of that type of thing. So just pay attention to where you're plucking two strings at the same time, and you'll be fine. Slow. almost end up fretting this kind of chord where you have the low E3, the D3, and the B3, and we're lifting off that middle one from time to time to sound some of the open chords. One more time, slow. Measures 39 and 40 round out the solo, and they sound like this. So that D chord, we're doing a double pluck, the open D and the open high E, and hammering on to the high E2, like that. And then we're pedaling off this open D all the time. So it's going up to an E5 here, and then a little pull off from E3 to 2 to B3 to the open D. One more time slow, measure 39. So it's very easy when you're always coming back to pedal on that same note. And measure 40 is kind of nice. So that lick changes to... Okay, let's look at the first part of that measure 40. So we're fretting the A3 and the B3. We pluck them both at the same time. We pluck the open D. The B3 back to the A3. And we do this neat thing with the open G and then the open D and G at the same time. So. And that lick changes a bit. We go from the high E1 to the E. Then we go from B3 to B, B1 to B, and then the G. From the top, those two parts slow.
I just found out a ghost left town. I just found out a ghost left town. I just found out a ghost left town. The Queen of California is a stepping down, down.
The pre-chorus 3 is very similar to pre-chorus 2, so I'm not going to get into that. What is different, though, is chorus number 3 starting at measure 51. We have that D shape. And he starts hitting eighth notes off the top of the measure and plucking two strings at the same time, but changing the top note. It's measure 51. So what we're doing is we're always plucking this open D, but we're changing the top note. The first time we're hitting the E2, high E2, we're hitting the G2, and we're hitting the B3. All the notes that we're fretting in our D shape here. So if you look at it another way, I'm plucking the fourth string in the first, fourth string and the third, fourth string and the second. And if you loop that, it sounds like this. And that just gives it a driving kind of feel before going, he settles down into his alteration here. So slow, measure 51. Little ghost note of an open G sounding off the end. And measure 52 has that C add 9 shape. And we're with our thumb, we're strumming the bottom end of that chord. And then with the first finger, picking off the melody. And the melody is... So we pick that off with our first finger. At the same time, we strum the bottom end. We're strumming anywhere between 3 and 2 strings on the top end of the chord. So that starts off measure 52. Strum with the thumb, strum again. First finger plucks the open E. Strum, plucks B3, open G, B3 again. Strum, open G, strum, and then end off with an open G and an open D. One more time without me, John. Top melody. while you're going the thumb. Next measure, measure 53, back to the D shape, but we're adding a bass note, the bass note, the low E 3. So we're plucking the outside of that D chord with this E 3 in the bass, so that's the high E 2 and the low E 3. Pluck those together, then pluck two more notes together, this time the open D and G 2, and then the open D and the high E 2 again before going into the alternating notes. Slow is. So that continues the theme with starting off with double plucked notes, double plucked eighth notes. And then back into a similar vein with the C add 9, though the melody is a bit different this time. One more time, I'll measure 54. Measure 55, bass back in the note, back in the D chord here, the E3. Pluck the outside of that, the inside of the chord, the open D and the G2. And then he starts missing some of the high notes. And then alternating his way out of there. He's winding things down at this point, so he's kind of being a bit softer. This kind of thing. And that takes us to measure 56. We have this, the bottom end of a C chord, and then he does this kind of thing. He does an F-E shape kind of thing. So off of that C, we hit a D3, and then with our thumb, we fret the E1, and we pluck the E1 and the open G at the same time. Then we hit that G with our thumb, and then we hit the B1, then we go to the open G, D3, and then G again, so one more time. It's a neat little replacement for the... Coming out of that final chorus, we have measures 57 and 58. They sound like this. Measure 58, slow, sounds like this. So the only thing in measure 57 is this lick. It's the first time we see that. So that is a pull-off from D2 to D0, and then a hammer-on from A to A2 before hitting the open G. So, and that hammer-on from the A to A2 is very fast. And then the context of the lick sounds like this. Measure 58, a bit different. Here, instead of going to the root note in the high note, we actually do the fretted D2 before going to those two open strings. So it sounds like this. Slight different. And then this part is similar. And we end off on that D3. So one more time, both measures slow. Is a theme we haven't seen before, and it consists of a bunch of driving bass notes over a melody that we play both at the same time. So measure 59, starting at 59, the melody sounds like this. And the driving bass line is just this low E3. So let's play measure 59 slow. So there's some notes we play at the same time, some places we play the bass note by itself, sometimes we play the melody note by itself. It's just a case of working out where those are. So the very first thing we play is the low bass note here. And then we play the bass note together with a D3. So we're playing this note. So back to the bass note, and then we have a D2, back to the bass note, and then the bass note and an open D at the same time. Bass note. Then we have a hammer-on from the A, open A to the A2. And as we do that hammer-on, we strike the bass note at the same time. So we do the open string, hammer-on, and pluck the bass note at the same time. This might be a new thing for some people, but it's to maintain that bass line happening at the same time as the melody. And then the last two notes are the open D and the open A. So one more time, slow without me talking. Pay attention to what we're playing individually and what we're playing notes together. 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 So again, the only really weird thing is that part where we're doing the open A to the A2, at the same time we're plucking that low E3. Next measure, measure 60, sounds like this. So that's interesting in that the melody is, we start off in a weird spot. We start off with this A3, then we pluck the D2 and bass note together, bass note by itself, open D, bass note by itself, bass note, and the A3. Real estate gets crowded here, we're doing adjacent strings. Then we do this bass string by itself, and then a really simple hammer-on from A2 to A3, and then A2 to open, finishing off with this quick bass note. So I'll play through that slow. And I'll draw attention to where we play together. 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 And with that bass note ending, that means the start of the next measure also starts with a bass note. So we have this thing happening. It's kind of neat. Let me play those first two measures together. So you can kind of see how it goes together. After that, we repeat the same theme with a couple little changes. So measure 61 sounds like this. Similar to what we saw before. Do it again slow. Again, single note, together, together. And I want to play you measures 60 and 61 so you hear that double bass note coming off of the ending and into the beginning of the next measure. Hear it? It's a nice little in there, so get that in. That's cool. Measure 62. We start off playing two notes at the same time. Let's go through that. And that features the only slap in the whole piece, oddly enough. So we start the measure off with the bass note and the A3. Pluck them both at the same time. And then we go right into two other notes at the same time, the D2 and the bass note. Bass note by itself, open D, bass note, back to the A3 and bass note at the same time. Then we do this neat thing using the bass note, like that. It's the bass note, a little bit of the A3, a slap, which kind of sounds the bass note at the same time, and then ending off with the A3 and a E3. So one more time, slow, measure 62. Get that bass note sounding when you slap, it's okay. It's kind of hard. It's probably a residual note. Next measure, 63. Same idea, just a different ending this time. So by this time we're getting where we have to pluck at the same time. So the ending is the only different part. It's a hammer-on from the open A to the A2 to the bass note. Ending off with the open D. The measure after that, 64, sounds like this. Very similar to what we've seen before. your 65. So we've seen this one before. Thank God, some repetition for a change. Measure 66. We're starting to slow down here. Instead of 105 beats per minute, we're coming down to about 88. So that last one, measure 66, sounds like this. We're hitting the bass note. We're hitting the D2 and the bass note together. Then we're hitting the bass note and then the open D, bass note again. Then we do these two really low two-note chords. Open E, this two-note chord. Then we strum from the A2 down all the open strings. So this thing with the chord here, the thing that I use to remember it is the two little two-note chords are kind of like opposites of each other. You keep the A2 and you fret that third E3 open, and then you just kind of move either your first finger or your thumb over. I don't recall what Mayer does, probably the thumb, to that E1. And then we strum from the A2 down. Let's play that one more time slow. Slowing it all down. And then we go into the very final measure, measure 67. We just hit the bass note. We do that hammer-on pull-off. We pluck those two notes before going into a G chord. And he actually frets it like this with his thumb. It's much more natural to do the G chord the traditional way. That's the E3, A2, open strings, and the high E3. Let's do the last two measures and run them into each other so you can kind of hear what they sound like. That's pretty much it. Hope you enjoyed it. It's always a pleasure to dissect these Mayer songs and look at the guts inside of them. It's always a pleasure. Thank you very much.